I stood in and spent some time because I know he'd have to go.
Which bit the people so that many of them died. Then the people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned in complaining against the Lord and you. Pray the Lord to take the serpents from us." So Moses prayed for the people, and the Lord said to Moses, "Make a seraph and mount it on the pole. And if any of you who have been bitten look at it, they will live." Moses accordingly made a bronze serpent and mounted it on a pole, and whenever anyone who had been bitten by a serpent looked at the bronze serpent, he lived. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. Jesus said to Nicodemus, no one has gone up to heaven except the one who has come down from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the desert, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so he who believes in him might not perish, but might have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Well, happy homecoming. It's so nice to see all of you here. This is a full gym. It's a beautiful thing. There's a lot of different images of Jesus, right? One of my favorite ones is baby Jesus, because he looks so cute in his little. There's also the shepherd Jesus. You guys see him with the shepherd, with the sheep on his shoulders. There's also the resurrected Jesus, or the Jesus whose heart is exposed. But there's only one picture of Jesus, one image of Jesus, that takes the cake on all of them. And that is the image of Jesus upon the cross. It's perhaps the oldest image of Jesus. And it tells us a lot about God, and it tells us a lot about what it means to be a Christian. God loves to look like that. That's how Jesus prefers to be looked upon. That's the image that we proclaim to the world. I love how in our reading, the Seraph Serpent, Jesus refers to himself that way. The Son of Man will be raised up. And Moses says, they will look upon that seraph serpent and they will be healed. And it's the same with this image. This image, for many years, has looked down upon the world, has been shown to the world, proclaimed, and it's healed the world. More things have been accomplished through a dead man upon a cross over the past 2,000 years than I think else. That's why we have hospitals and universities. It came from that. But what does that show us? Christianity is a project whereby the man upstairs comes downstairs. Let me put it a different way. Because I'm a priest, a lot of people come up to me and they say, hey, Father, how's the man upstairs doing? And I say, well, what do you mean? You just missed the point. The point of Christianity is that the man upstairs came downstairs. He came downstairs to bring us upstairs. And he brings us upstairs by bringing heaven down here. By bringing it down to our lowliest places. The places that are most cross-like. Whenever I feel like I'm in a well, like I'm just dug down, people don't care about me. People love to throw prayers at me. Sometimes they throw prescriptions at me. And they love to say, oh, it's okay. You'll get out of the well eventually. But there's only one person who really goes down into the well with me, to the deepest parts, and that's Jesus. Just a while back, my grandpa, actually, he just passed away. It's really sad. And my very last conversation with him, I felt really bad because he was in pain. He was on his deathbed. And at the foot of his bed, there was an image of the resurrected Jesus. And I said, Grandpa, isn't that great? Look, you have such a nice view of Jesus. He shook his head and said, yeah, Jesus. And he pointed behind me. Right next to his bed, there was this little crucifix. He said, that's the Jesus I'm going to look at. Jesus had to carry his cross, even though he didn't really want to. And it was a profound lesson for me that for a Christian, our primary consolation should come from the sufferings of Christ. Christ rose from the dead, that should give us hope, yes. But even more so, that he's in your lives right now in your very crosses. God seems to love to heal us by joining us in the well. You guys know that I like the Rubik's Cube, right? So the very first step to the Rubik's Cube, how it begins, is with a cross. I always love that. The rest of the cube doesn't make sense unless you build a cross on the bottom of it. I imagine that that's the same thing with all of us as Christians. Nothing really makes sense in our lives unless we begin with the cross. And my niece and nephew, they have these like little puzzle boxes. You know, like circles go into the circle hole, and squares go into the square hole, and triangles go into the triangle hole. And when they're learning their shapes, a lot of times they get it mixed up. Sometimes they put the circle in the square hole, and sometimes they put the triangle in the rectangle hole. And it doesn't really work, obviously, how it's supposed to, but for them, it fits in there. But there's one shape that always struck me, doesn't really fit anywhere else, and that is the cross hole. That's the only one that they just can't figure out. And I imagine that's the same way with the end of our life. If the Rubik's Cube is like the beginning, where all good things begin with the cross, all good things also end with the cross. Jesus Christ went into heaven after enduring his passion and death. And so he made a cross-shaped door into heaven. And if we ever imagine that we're going to get there, if we ever imagine that we're going to fit through that door, we have to look like this, where we give up our whole lives for Jesus, for God. Brothers and sisters, this is the exaltation of the cross. And this is the most precious image of Jesus that we've ever had. And how beautiful an image it is, and how beautiful an image it is for us to make us saints. God has given us his only Son for our salvation. Therefore, we can hope that he will likewise fulfill all of our other needs. We now present those needs to him with confidence.
Thank you.
dear brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
Protect the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for the laws of the Church.
May this oblation, O Lord, which on the altar of the cross cancel the offense of the whole world, cleanse us, we pray, of all our sins, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for you place the salvation of the human race on the wood of the cross, so that where death arose, life might come again spring forth, and the evil one who conquered on a tree might likewise on a tree be conquered through Christ our Lord. Through him the angels praise your majesty, dominions adore, and powers tremble before you. Heaven and the virtues of heaven and the blessed seraphim worship together with exaltation. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in humble praise as we are king.
For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me.
Lord,
I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who will live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.